Dear brothers and sisters, praise the Lord. It's time to read the Bible again. This week we are going to read chapter 6. In chapter 5, we saw the ancestors on the lines of life, from Adam to Noah, total of 10 generations. Among those, the 7th generation that saw a way to escape the death after man's sin. That is to walk with God, just like Enoch. Eventually, he did not see death. He was taken away by God. To man's 10th generation, Noah, God showed us a way for a corporate salvation. God's judgment will surely come, but even in his judgment, God still has his mercy and grace. God's grace came upon Noah and his family. From chapter 6, God seemed to slow down the pace and let us see clearly about Noah's life. In Genesis chapter 1 to 6, recorded man's 3 falls. The first fall recorded in chapter 3, verse 6. Our ancestors, Adam and Eve, they ate from the tree of knowledge of good and evil that God commanded them not to eat from. So they were drove out of the Garden of Eden. They could not have the intimate relationship, fellowship with God anymore. They lose the function of their spirits, or that their spirits died. Then in chapter 4, verse 8, man's second generation, Cain, on the matter of offering sacrifices, he was jealous of God's favored Abel's offering, but did not look at his, and therefore he killed his brother Abel. This was man's second fall, and Cain was driven out of the presence of the Lord and became a restless and wanderer on the earth. And the descendants of Cain developed a man-made religion and humanistic culture. And then man's third fall, recorded in chapter 6, verses 1 to 4. In verse 3, even say that, "For that he also is flesh." So God set his judgment day for this corrupted world. Man's third fall must be so severe so that God could not forbear anymore and had to let judgment come. What exactly happened during man's third fall? We'll study this today. I have to mention that Genesis 6 verses 1 to 4 is a difficult theological problem in the Bible. Different theologians have different opinions about this. Therefore, I'll ask you to keep an open mind and bring these different opinions to the Lord in your prayers or meditations and see which explanation is more logic to you. You must keep an open mind, though, to the other different opinions, an inclusive attitude towards others who have different views. I believe God allows this until Jesus Christ comes again. Then we'll all reach the same one truth. Before then, we pray that our love may abound yet more and more in knowledge and in all judgment. Pray that we may approve things that are excellent, that we may be sincere and without offense till the day of Jesus Christ. Let's start Genesis 6, verses 1 to 3. And it came to pass, when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born unto them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men were beautiful, and they married any of them they choose. And the Lord said, "My spirit shall not always strive with man, for that he also is flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years." These first three verses were short, but the result was earth-shaking. because God regarded man had become flesh through what happened, and his spirit will not always strive wisdom, and set the limit for man's life to 120 years. But exactly what had happened in verse 1 and 2, there are two groups of people, man's daughters and sons of God. Because sons of God and man's daughters together, they produce an illegal marriage relationship that God had to come and judge. And we have to ask exactly who are the sons of God and daughters of men. And this is exactly the difficult part that we talked about earlier. There are many different explanations about, but two of them are most accepted theories. One believes that the sons of God refer to the descendants of Abel, recorded in chapter 5, in the line of life. Each generation, only one person was recorded in the genealogy. But after 10 generations, there were a lot of people. These few that were recorded in the genealogy, they belonged to God. Therefore, they were the sons of God. And the daughters of men, they explained they were Cain's descendants' children, especially from Lamech. From the seventh generation, he married to two wives, had three sons and one daughter, Naama. She's the ancestor of the cosmetic industry to beautify oneself to please men. Therefore, these beautiful ladies were the ladies from the line of knowledge of good and evil. Many great Bible teachers believe in this theory. For me, I have hard time to believe that God would judge men so severely based on above theory. I prefer the following second theory. They think the sons of God refer to the fallen angels, and the daughters of men refer to all daughters born from Adam to Noah. In chapter 1, in God's creation, God repeatedly said, each according to its kind. And after creating man, God created Adam first and then took something out of Adam and built a woman for him. And this has established the principle for marriage. God's heart's desire is for Eve to be out of Adam, and after married to Adam, to bear sons and daughters for Adam, and became the mother of all living. But because of man's fall, gradually man's spirit reduced to no function, and man's soul was corrupted and became independent from God, and had a living and culture that's without God. But man still has the outward likeness of God and man-made, that God made originally. In chapter 6, the sons of God, these fallen angels and the daughters of men came together and have another race that was not created by God. Therefore, God had to come and judge the situation. Otherwise, the entire human race will be corrupted by it. And the offspring of the woman will not crush the Satan's head. But are there proofs of this theory that the sons of God are the fallen angels? First, in Job chapter 1, verse 6, it says, now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them. In the Bible, the angels created by God also were called the sons of God. Like Job 1:6, it says, when the sons of God came before the Lord, Satan came also among them. This tells us that those fallen angels and Satan were called the Son of God. Also in Job chapter 2, verse 1, the same thing. Again, there was a day when the sons of God, or some version says angels, came to present themselves before the Lord. Satan came also among them to present himself before the Lord. So we see that God created angels sometimes were called the sons of God. But according to God's divine order, angels should neither marry nor be given in marriage. It's recorded in Matthew chapter 22, verse 30. The seducers, who said there is no resurrection, came to Jesus with a tricky question, that there were seven brothers, they all married to the same woman at different times. And at resurrection, whose wife will she be of these seven brothers? Jesus answered them in verse 30. It says, at the resurrection, people will neither marry nor be given in marriage. They will be like the angels in heaven. This tells us that the angels neither marry nor be given in marriage. When men die and resurrected, they will be just like the angels. This is God's divine order. However, in Genesis chapter 6, verse 2, we see that these fallen angels went against God's order. They marry the daughters of men as they choose. This matter greatly offended God, to a degree that God had to use the great flood to judge the whole earth. And God also judged the fallen angels. This is recorded in Jude verse 6. It says, and the angels who did not keep their positions of authority, but abandoned their own home, this he has kept in darkness, bound with everlasting chains for judgment on the great day. The angels mentioned here, who did not keep their position of authority, should refer to the angels in Genesis 6, verse 2, who saw the daughters of men were beautiful and married them by their choice. According to Jewish belief, that God lives in the third heaven and men live on earth. Satan and all the fallen angels live in the air. They are the prince of the powers of the air. They did not keep their positions in the air and came to earth. Therefore, God bound them with the everlasting chains in the darkness for judgment on that great day. This is mentioned in Revelation chapter 20. At the end of the millennium kingdom, Satan and all the fallen angels who follow him will be thrown into the lake of fire and brimstone. These fallen angels, recorded in Jude verse 6, they left their position in the air. And what exactly did they do? The answer is in Jude verse 7. It says, in a similar way, Sodom and Gomorrah and the surrounding towns gave themselves up to sexual immorality and perversion. They serve as an example of those who suffer the punishment of eternal fire. We know later in Genesis 19, we'll read about the stories about Sodom and Gomorrah. The people in these two towns followed the example left by the fallen angels. They gave themselves up to sexual immorality and perversion. King James Version translated as going after strange flesh. This was against God's original principle for man's marriage and how children should come from. Therefore, verse 3, the Lord said that men had become flesh. My spirit will not always strive with them. When men sinned and cast out of the Garden of Eden, although men could not have intimate fellowship with the Lord anymore, God's spirit still came upon them often to remind them to strive with them because men's conscience was still still in their spirit. Like in Genesis 4, verse 5, when God did not look at Cain's offering and he was very angry, God came to Cain and said to him, "Why are you angry? Why is your face downcast? If you do what is right, will you not be accepted?" Here, it tells us that God's spirit still strives with men and hoping that men will make different decisions. And in chapter 6, when man became flesh, man's soul corrupted to a degree that's almost with no function anymore. So God's spirit will not strive with man anymore. God will not remind man anymore because man was totally corrupted. Even so, his days could still be 120 years. There are also two kinds of theories about this 120 years. One theory says that it's from that time after 120 years, the flood will come. We know when the flood came, Noah was 600 years old. This means that when Noah was 480 years old, God had decided that 120 years later, he would judge the world with the flood. Maybe it's also because of this. Noah became the father to Shem, Ham, and Japheth after Noah was 500 years old. God revealed to Noah to build an ark. Noah knew that as long as he's faithfully done what God has commanded him to do, to walk with God, he and his family shall be saved. And the other theory is that you can also see this 100 years as the lifespan God has set for man after man's fall and became flesh. In Genesis 11, we'll see from Noah's descendants, the lifespan has gradually decreased. Noah still lived for 950 years, same as his ancestors, but Shem lived for 600 years and going downwards to Abraham's father, Terah. He only lived for 205 years old. Man's lifespan gradually reduced to what God has ordained as 120 years. Verse 4, the Napoleons were on the earth in those days, and afterwards, when the sons of God went to the daughters of men and had children by them, they were the heroes of old, men of renown. The Chinese Union Version's translation seems very positive. Actually, it's a very negative situation. Nephilims actually is better translated as giant. They are not created by God originally. They came from those fallen angels with the daughters of men. They were tall and huge. They were those heroes of old, men of renown. They were also those people who did not regulate it by anything and developed abnormally. If we use today's scientific opinion, the fallen angels and the daughters of men produce another race that's not in God's original creation, and it will totally corrupt human race's DNA. If God did not come and deal with this situation, we will not be in existence. But because of man's fall and human's DNA was corrupted, after a few generations, man's lifespan became shorter and shorter, eventually to what God has ordained within 120 years. Dear brothers and sisters, chapter 6, the first four verses, although there are many different explanations about them, God's heart's desire is very clear. Because man's fall and even became flesh, totally against what God has originally created man for. Therefore, God had to come and judge the world. And this temptation in our flesh is still alive today. May God help us through our daily reading His words, daily prayers. We can turn to God. We can learn to crucify our flesh with the passions and the lusts on the cross. Let us understand God's will and love what God loves and obey the leadings of the Holy Spirit in us. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for letting us see that those who put their minds on the flesh, you will surely judge. Help us to turn to you, to obey the leadings of the Holy Spirit. Pray that you will help us to learn to be a person who knows how to walk with you. Bless my life today. Pray in Jesus' name. Amen.